A study came out last month that doesn't seem to be very encouraging for longevity biohackers. The study is called The Implausibility of Radical Life Extension in Humans in the 21st Century. But it's not as bad as it seems. Not at all. When I first read this study, it was with some trepidation, I'll admit. It worried me a little bit. But after I read it, I realized that I could breathe a sigh of relief. Stick around and I'll explain. What this study is really looking at is the rate of increase in life expectancy. So we'll start out with a little historical perspective on life expectancy, just to set the stage for examining this study. Next, we'll take a look at the study itself and the conclusions that the researchers arrived at. Finally, I'll put in my two cents worth and explain why I don't think that this study will impact anyone trying to extend their own longevity. But first, I want to make sure that you guys know about my new longevity community, the Longevity Alliance. It's on school.com, and it's totally free, now and forever. Join the community and get access to the online course, The Foundations of Longevity, and participate in our weekly live Q&A sessions. But mostly, just engage in the community, ask questions, provide answers to someone else's questions, meet like-minded individuals. I think that this community will become pretty well known for its level of engagement. Now, if this sounds like something you'd like to do, go check it out right up here. There's also a link down in the description below. All right, let's get into it. Like I said, we're going to start with a bit of historical perspective on life expectancy. For most of the last 2,000 years, life expectancy increased by about 1 year for every century or two. And my guess is that most of that happened in the last few centuries. By the middle of the 19th century, most people could expect to live into their late 30s. So why so low? Why has life expectancy been so low for most of our existence? Because the risk for mortality, for dying, was really high. A very large percentage of humanity died in childbirth or in infancy, and a lot of the rest were fatalities. They died by accident, in a conflict, in a war, or were outright killed. Hardly anyone had much of a chance of reaching their full longevity potential. But something happened around the beginning of the 20th century. Science had progressed to the point where discoveries in medicine and in public health changed everything. We entered a period of what's called radical life extension. Now that's defined as an extension of the average life expectancy of about 3 years per decade, instead of a year every century or two. That comes to 0.3 years annually. That's a little less than 4 months of increased life expectancy per year. So the phrase radical life extension is defined as an annual increase in life expectancy of at least 0.3 years. Okay, so this radical improvement in life expectancy started with better conditions in early life. Deaths for childbirth and infant mortality went way down. Next came middle-aged people. More and more people were surviving middle age and living to become elderly. Finally, attention was focused on seniors, and age-related chronic diseases killed fewer people each year. But you gotta wonder, how long could this continue? Up to this point, the increase in life expectancy was a result of removing mortality risk factors, of eliminating the things that killed us. Anything that can kill us, anything that is a cause of death, is a mortality risk factor. Whether it's dying in childbirth, or from a contagious disease, or being killed in a war, or dying in a parachuting accident, they all have a defined risk for mortality. When all those risks start to get really low, life expectancy gets higher. But there's a limit to how low those risks can get. They can't get lower than zero. And so increasing life expectancy by lowering mortality risk factors starts to become ineffective. It doesn't work anymore. And we kind of reached that point around 1990. That's when a new theory was proposed. It was called the limited lifespan hypothesis. And it went something like this. Humanity was approaching an upper limit to life expectancy. They figured that most of the early gains in medicine and in public health had already been made. that left biological aging as the primary risk factor for mortality. So they predicted that the rate of improvement in life expectancy would go into decline in the 21st century. They thought that life expectancy would settle somewhere around 85, and that was it. That was the maximum life expectancy that they believed the human race would ever achieve. However, there was a caveat to this hypothesis. They stated that this would come to pass unless an intervention into biological aging was discovered. But in order for this discovery to radically extend life expectancy, it would have to be tested for safety and efficacy, and then be widely distributed and available to large percentages of the population. Now, as you might imagine, this was controversial, and it spawned another competing theory called the radical lifespan extension hypothesis. And it claimed that the limited lifespan hypothesis didn't take into account ongoing advances in medicine and biology. It also believed that radical life extension had already begun or would soon occur. And they predicted that most newborns would live to see 100 years. Okay, so that's kind of what this new study is about. It's titled The Implausibility of Radical Life Extension in Humans in the 21st Century. Now, the radical life extension in the title refers to the annual requirement of at least 3/10 of a year of increased life extension. And as you might guess by the title, this study isn't very optimistic. They concluded that survival to 100 years of age is unlikely to exceed 15% for females and 5% for males, suggesting that unless the processes of biological aging can be slowed down, radical life extension is unlikely in this century. All right, so this study set out to address a few questions. First, has radical life extension, by definition, occurred at any time since 1990? Now, they ended this study in 2019 because they didn't want COVID-19 to confound the results. So there's no data in this study since 2019. However, that data does exist and it's readily available. The second question they wanted to address was, how likely was it that newborns would live to see 100 years? Third, they wanted to examine what rate of change in future mortality risk would be required to raise life expectancy at birth by 1 year. They also wanted to determine what human survival rates would have to look like if radical life extension were to occur in this century, and how likely is that to happen? Okay, so the study used several large databases, including the Human Mortality Database, as source material for this study. And they looked at how well humanity has performed at extending life expectancy in the past. They looked at parameters that allow scientists to be successful in the past and compared them to the current parameters. And within these same parameters, they examined what would be required to prod life expectancy into advancing more quickly, or at all. Now, they limited this data to the 7 countries with the longest life expectancy, plus Hong Kong and the United States. And they divided the data by gender. Okay, so let's take a look at their response to the questions based on the data that they uncovered. First up, has radical life extension occurred at any time since 1990. So they broke the data down into 3 decades, from 1990 to 2000, from 2000 to 2010, and from 2010 to 2019, because of COVID, remember? So the standard that they were looking for was at least 3 years of increased life expectancy per decade, or an average of 3/10 of a year annually. And here's what they found. The decades are down here at the bottom of the chart, and the annual change in life expectancy at birth is on the left, in years, or in 10ths of a year. From 1990 until 2000, with the exception of Hong Kong, none of the countries achieved radical life extension. Most were around 2.5 tenths. The U.S. was down around 1.5 tenths. From 2000 until 2010, some countries saw a slight increase, but still below the threshold for radical life extension. Some countries saw a decline. Now, one exception to this was South Korea. They were the only country to see radical life extension in that decade. Then, in the almost a decade, from 2010 to 2019, things just got worse. With the exception of Hong Kong, every country saw a decline in the advancement of life expectancy. Even South Korea saw a decline, but they were still achieving radical life expectancy. Some even saw life expectancy at birth that was lower than at the start of the decade, and the U.S. was the worst. According to the study, from 1990 to 2019, that's 29 years, the average increase in life expectancy across all nine countries was just 6.5 years, a 6.5-year increase in almost 30 years. That's a little over 0.2 years annually. In the U.S., this was caused by an increase in mortality at middle ages. Now, what's interesting is that this same phenomenon happened in the early and mid 20th century, but it was caused by extreme events like the Spanish flu and war-related deaths. Remember, this study stopped before COVID hit. Now, like I said, although this study stops in 2019, the data for the remaining years is readily available. Now, although I'm sure it's available, I didn't collect data for the nine countries in this study, just for the U.S. In 2020 and 2021, primarily because of COVID, we saw a negative rate of change in life expectancy. In 22 and 23, there was a slight increase in the rate of change, but life expectancy is still below pre-COVID. So, the conclusions? For the last three decades, we have not, or at least very rarely, achieved the requirement for radical life extension. Looks like the limited lifespan hypothesis was right after all. Okay, bummer. But what about our chances of living to 100? A little bit better news there. This graph shows the percentage of the population that's still alive at 100 years for each country for each year since 1990. Again, Hong Kong did really well, with almost 8% of their population still kicking it at 100. But all countries are trending upwards. Across the board, everyone saw slightly better numbers, from around 1% in 1990 to around 2.5% in 2019. Okay, so next, they looked at the reduction in risks for all-cause mortality that would be required to raise life expectancy by 1 year. And the first thing that they found was that the percentage of reduction in total mortality required to achieve this had increased relative to 1990. They used Japan as an illustration of typical conditions present in most long-lived countries. All-cause mortality for all ages would have to decline by 20.3% for life expectancy to rise by 1 year, from 88 to 89 for females in Japan. For males, total mortality would have to decline by 9.5%, raising life expectancy from 82 to 83. Finally, they examined what survival dynamics would have to look like for radical life extension to occur in this century. Again, using data from Japan, they looked at hypothetically raising life expectancy in Japan to 110. To achieve this, all-cause mortality for all ages up to the hypothetical age of 150 would have to be 88% lower than the observed death rate at age 109 in Japan in 2019. It would require the cure or elimination of most major causes of death. This means cancer, stroke, heart attack, diabetes, Alzheimer's, all age-related chronic diseases. It would require that 70% of females would have to live to the age of 100, 70%. Survival to the age of 122.45 years, which is the age of the longest living human on record, Jean Calment of France, would have to be attained by 24% of all women in Japan. 6% would have to reach 150 plus years. That's 28 years beyond the observed limit to reach an average life expectancy of 110 years in Japan. That's in a country where the average life expectancy is already around 83 to 88 years in 2019. Okay, so that's what this study had to say. And on the surface, that's not very good news for us longevity biohackers. But here's the thing you got to keep in mind. Average life expectancy, which is the only thing that this study examined, is a statistical average of a population. It doesn't consider the individual. Historically, when the average life expectancy was around 25 to 30, it didn't mean that you were old and worn out at 25 or 30. It meant that there were enough people who were dying a lot younger that they dragged down the average. If they didn't die of something else, if they didn't get killed, then individuals were still capable of reaching what we would call old age today, 60, 80, even 100. And when determining life expectancy, they used what's called a disease model of life. That's based on the idea that when most people die, it's because of a disease, usually a chronic disease like cancer or cardiovascular disease. Now, this is different than it used to be. In the past, while a lot of people still died from diseases, although it was usually a contagious disease, a lot of people died in infancy or were killed. The problem today is that disease is becoming less and less the primary cause of death. If the limited lifespan hypothesis is right, and it looks like it is, then biological aging is replacing disease as the primary risk factor for death. But there's another problem. In my opinion, one of the factors that contributes to our low rate of increase in life expectancy is the lifestyle choices of most people living in countries where the advances in medicine and public health are widely available. 60% of people living in first world countries are considered to be overweight or obese. 60%. Most of us are choosing a lifestyle that is sedentary and unhealthy, consuming junk food and getting fat. When that's most of us, that's going to offset whatever advances in medical science and public health are being made. And it's going to drive down life expectancy. So it's really no surprise that the study came to the conclusion that it did. But consider this. Remember that the limited lifespan hypothesis stated that biological aging was becoming the primary risk factor for death, and that what they predicted would come to pass unless an intervention in biological aging was discovered. And this study itself stated that unless the process of biological aging can be slowed down, radical life extension seems pretty unlikely in this century. And that's what longevity biohackers are all about, slowing biological aging. This study doesn't address the advances in longevity science at all. It doesn't consider things like stem cell therapy or regenerative medicine or senolytics or any of the other longevity strategies whatsoever. The limited lifespan hypothesis, which this study seems to prove or at least validate, it states that for interventions in biological aging to have a significant impact on average life expectancy, they have to be tested for safety and efficacy, and they have to be widely available to most citizens. And I think that's going to happen. It'll start with the early adopters, the longevity biohackers. And for us, it's going to be a little spendy. But as it becomes more universal, its cost will come way down and it'll be available to the masses. And maybe when the people making poor lifestyle choices see the extreme age that's possible, they'll stop making those choices. And that's when I think we'll see advances in life expectancy that are truly radical, by anyone's definition. It'll make the current 3 years per decade standard for radical life extension look as primitive as the old 1 year per century standard looks to us now. Okay, I'm out of here. Don't forget to check out the Longevity Alliance on school.com. And I'll see you guys next time. Stay strong, stay healthy.